So now I'd like to introduce the second speaker, Mr. Fadia Schenker. Mr. Fadia Schenker is a co-founder and director of the startup Faster. Faster is a company based in Bangalore and Chennai, India. They focus on building 3D printing solutions in a range of industries. He's a graduate of IIT Madras from the Electrical Science Department. He has worked with Bosch and collaborated with a range of manufacturing companies. He has deep expertise in design and manufacturing of machine components. After graduating, Mr. Fadia Schenker founded the company Faster with his partners to focus on 3D printing solutions. Faster is currently collaborating with IIT Madras, a premier engineering institute in India, to make 3D printing structures a reality. The focus of the company is to build good 3D printers, machines, systems, and processes that are suitable for the Indian landscape. And Faster has successfully built not only the 3D printers, but also the auxiliary systems that are necessary to make the process work. Faster has engaged with industry partners and institutions to make 3D printing a reality. So let's welcome Mr. Fadia Schenker to deliver his talk on 3D printing, machines, systems, and technologies.
Thank you. Am I audible? Good afternoon. Ladies, gentlemen, and my fellow researchers from across the globe. First of all, it's an honor for me to present in front of Dr. Koshnavis. And he's been some sort of a hero for us back in the campus. Most of the stuff that we had to discover over a period of time to a large extent dependent on the material and the videos that he had put forward. I really thank him. And also I would like to thank Loughborough University for all the material that they had put out. In India, the context primarily with respect to construction is pretty conservative at this point of time. So their adoption towards new technologies and implementation of the same in the field is pretty laid back. That is how I would put it. But suddenly 3D printing in construction is being spoken all over the world, and even in the Indian context, you know, it's been picked up and a lot of people are discussing at this point of time. Primarily I'm from machine building background, and I've handled a lot of machine both during my tenure with Robert Bosch, which is based out of Germany, and even when I came back to India to pursue my master's and PhD. So I was primarily in the automation space. 3D printing as such, for me as an overall experience, has been primarily towards polymers and metals than concrete. So compared to all of you, my understanding would be a little limited. But on the machine side of things, I think I have contributed along with my partner. Oh, he's not there, okay. Along with my partner to a large extent. And I would try to present my humble findings and the kind of work that we have done over the course of next 10 odd minutes. Okay, so with respect to construction, primarily our startup and in collaboration with IIT Madras, it's an academic institute based out of Chennai. It's in the southern part of the country. Primarily, the goal is to work towards three different things. And the first machine being the mobile 3D printer. That is what our professors wanted. But we had to cover a lot of ground before we go there. So we started off with the usual gantry-based design before we touched the mobile side of things. And binder jetting as such was a accident, or I would say a happy accident in the construction space, because my relation with binder jetting was primarily for the casting industries, which exists in the automotive space. And my professor wanted to try a couple of materials, primarily gypsum and ceramics. So we used the same system. And then, I don't know how many of you actually heard Manu Santanam's lecture yesterday. So he's our concrete researcher. He's an academician. So he had the requirement to basically have a small printer with which he could characterize his materials, and that's how we came about this whole R&D 3D printer. To a large extent, I will try to explain how is it that we do things using one of the printers as an example. And today I would like to choose the R&D 3D printer that we have developed. And if I'm able to finish it quickly, I'll move into the other ones. The goal primarily for this R&D 3D printer was to ensure that we have enough and more materials to play around with. And during the process of characterizing these materials, to a large extent, we didn't want to be bogged down by wasting a lot of materials. And the focus was to discover as many number of mixes as possible. So to a large extent, we kept this printer small. And we've also achieved whatever we wanted using this. So as shown in the presentation, these are the four different uses that we have for this research 3D printer. So the system primarily consists of three different aspects. One is the primer, and the second is the pump, and third is the printer. Primer, to a large extent, for what we use is primarily for compaction, and this will be used as an input for the pump, and the actions of the pump thereof will be dependent of the material that comes from the primer. There are also certain reasons why we separated the mixer from the primer is because we didn't want the setting time to be an influence on this printer. And then, of course, the pumping mechanism itself. Though we requested a lot of people around the globe and we wrote a lot of mails, the support that we got in the pump space was very limited. So this whole pump as such had to be completely developed from scratch. And then the printer part. In the printer, what we are proud of as such is the nozzle system that we have developed. And one of the madams during the morning discussion had asked about a question related to the aggregates. So our printer as such at this point of time, we have been able to characterize up to 8 mm at this point of time. And in about a year's time, we are willing to go much forward than that. And there is a very unique proprietary design that we have done, which connects the primer and the pump. And the design as such has been articulated based on the thoughts along the following lines, that when the aggregates as such comes and hits the valve, so to say, the aggregate cannot damage the valve primarily. And the most important aspect of that is that the aggregate itself cannot break. So the shear forces are very minimal, and there is something proprietary that we have done over there. And then the pumping mechanism itself, we had to make sure that the compaction is not too much. At the same time, it is enough to push. And the materials which was given to us over a period of time was extremely variable. So some had a lot of open time, some had very narrow range of open time per se. And then the other bit as such is when the concrete sets down on the workbed, the design statement that was given to us was that it has to behave like a solid, but when the pumping action as such is happening, it has to move like a liquid. And then there is also a nozzle over here. I don't know whether it's clear in this image from there. This nozzle also, we have created a simple mechanism over there to ensure that there are no dead concrete over there. So all the concrete that is being pumped out actually comes out of the pump, but whatever is there in the pipes as such at this point of time, you know, we are still trying to characterize as to how to utilize them. And we are also quite self-sustainable that way, that we invented or we created our own softwares for this, and the electronics for some simple systems, we picked up the off-the-shelf available material, but mostly the electronics also is something that we have worked on and we have characterized. And to give you a perspective, the way how we went about doing things was there would be a problem statement given to us, And based on the problem statement, we would ideally characterize a proof of concept. And based on the results of proof of concept, we would articulate a machine. That's how we have been doing. This is the overall spec sheet, I would say. And the professor was very clear that the printer itself has to be sub 1 ton because most of the small transport vehicles in India, I don't know how it is over here, the carrying capacity is about 1 ton, beyond which it becomes a commercial vehicle and all of that. And then the dimensions are as what it is. And the concrete flow rate, please don't judge us that it is just 2 liters per minute. The reason why we have limited it to 2 liters per minute at this point of time is to make sure that the open time that is available in the concrete mix itself is utilized to the maximum potential over here. Whereas the standard available components, to a large extent, they have high flow rate, some to the tune of 10 liter per minute, and we have seen some up to 50 liter per minute. And then that really doesn't help in the R&D stage, especially while developing materials. The operating pressure range of the pump itself is about 20 bars. That is what we have designed it for. But the safe operating pressure range, definitely towards the material that we have developed, is about 8 to 10 bar. That is how much we have. There are certain mixes as such where the resistance that is offered by the mixture to the pump itself has been about 14, 14.5 bars. So this is something that I thought I'll share with all of you. And the range as such is 15 liters. And please don't mind me, I've made a typo. This is not liters, this is in kilograms. And the way how we were able to make this pump itself has been because of the articulation that my colleague over here had, and also the our ability to basically implement the other aspects of mechanical engineering and other machines which are there in the market at this point of time into the concrete itself. And that's the reason you know, we were reasonably successful with our pump effort, and probably we are the only guys who have done it. I'm not too sure. Then the graphs as such, I don't know whether it is visible, but this is a graph of performance versus current. And software and electronics. Electronics, I'll not get into the details of the architecture of the electronics itself, but I would like to tell you the process and what it does. So primarily, the feedbacks that we wanted was, one is the complete feedback on the pump so that we don't have to operate it mechanically or even through a different electronics channel. And the second as such is the layer height correction while the 3D printing is going on. This layer height correction as such, we found a lot of interesting results when the height difference between the concrete being laid and the distance to the nozzle. And this is something that you know, we have characterized to a large extent. And also the implementation of twist while the printing is going on gives a lot of good results from what we have seen. We use a flow rate sensor for the pump aspects of things, and then proximity sensor for the Z. And this is also integrated into our software so that new researchers and people who want to specifically work only on the concrete and the raw material side of things need not know too much about the printer at this point of time. And the range of operation of this printer is pretty large at this point of time, and it's quite intuitive that way. This is a small image of our UX that we have. The print primarily, or the component itself that comes out of the printer, depends on the shape of the nozzle and the type of the nozzle that is used. We have, to a large extent, characterized about 8 different types of nozzle. And then there are certain basic tests that we have done ourselves, which is part of the software that we have developed, which can be done to get results so that, you know, most of the other people, whoever are working on our printer, need not spend too much time in figuring out things that has already been done. And the get used to time for this printer is very minimal. That is the reason why we have done this. And at this point of time, we are also working on a nozzle that can be variable, both in terms of cross-section as well as geometry. Probably the next year when we are here, we will be able to showcase that to you. And then one of the most important part of 3D printing itself is slicing. And I was looking forward yesterday and day before, yesterday, both during the morning and the afternoon section, that someone would speak about slicing. I will not get into what slicing is and all of that, because I'm sure that most of you know what it is already. What we have done, apart from the standard operations of slicing, one is the support generation. This was something that we got inspired from the FDM technology, which is there, where there is something called a water-soluble filament. And we wanted to have something very similar for 3D printing and construction, so that the support structures which are built can be easily dissolvable in water. This opens up a lot of possibility of printing against gravity. This is one. And then we have developed a lot of infill patterns, and one of them is shown in this presentation. And auto alignment of nozzle head with the print direction. Of course, a lot of people have worked on auto alignment, but auto alignment, when done using parameters from the concrete mix itself, is some sort of a challenge, and not a lot of material is available online. And this is one area where we have put in a lot of efforts. And this is something that my colleague already explained in the morning, but nevertheless, I'll get into the details of it. We've conducted various tests on all the materials that we have done. So the compressive strength values that we are getting is somewhere in the range of 70 to 80 MPa. And we conducted various extrudability tests and flowability tests. And we also established the boundary conditions for each material. And we, to a large extent, when we do a design concept of sorts, we know the range in which the concrete can operate. And we can also tell you that intuitively using our software. We've also optimized on that bit. And what we are yet to characterize in our experiment at this point of time is accelerated testing in terms of time. And what happens, say, after 10 years, and what happens basically by the improvement of creep factors while the experimentation is going on, is something that we do not know, and not too much material is available. And this is one of the works that we are doing, where creep characterization on the material which is built. And if anyone in the audience has done some work extensively on the creep and the associated values, you know, I would be more than happy to, you know, discuss with you. And binder jetting as such, as I told you earlier, this was primarily done for automotive industry, for making sand molds as such. Over here, the way how it happened is, you know, they also wanted to try ceramics and gypsum. So because of which, you know, we extended the same to this. The print head type is a piezoelectric print head, and the rate, it's not a print rate exactly, it's exactly the scanning speed. It's about 50 mm per second. The size is 290 mm cube at this point of time. And we work on two types of binders. One is an alcohol-based binders, and the second is water-based. The future work, that is what we are planning to do in the next couple of years or 3 years, is first of it is the on-site printing, where the printer itself will be mobile. Today, I saw a couple of presentations in which dual robots were working towards building a structure together. We would try to extend that logic and extend that design itself into something where the printer has some mobility on its own. And the second is factory-based printing system, because this is very, very relevant in India, because the on-site conditions, I don't know, when the presentations were made the last day, how they are going to manage the on-site printing itself. But I, according to me, and from what we believe as our company, is basically the factory setup needs to be done first, where the components will be made as a precast and then assembled on site. And for that, you know, we have fixed on one particular axis, which is Y, and then the X will continuously increase. And this is what we have in terms of factory-based setup. And what is it that we have as our advantages at this point of time is, as we work on the software, the electronics, mechanical design, the manufacturing, all by ourselves, and we also have the necessary people and industry collaborations to pull it off, we are able to a large extent, sort out most of our issues by ourselves. The proprietary software that we have is something that we are really proud of, and something that was developed by us from scratch. And we have some strong collaboration only in the Indian context. We are trying for some collaborations abroad as well. And in-house manufacturing capabilities is basically we have our own setup where most of the manufacturing can be done. And what I would also like to say as such is, at this point of time, these R&D printer that I spoke to you about is being used by a couple of concrete manufacturers in India. They are one of the largest. And the printer itself, one of the factory-based printers that we are planning to make, is being used by one of the big company, or probably the biggest company in the country, L&T. And mostly we have gotten good feedbacks, and that's about it. Wait, 1 second, I'll just see if I've missed out on anything. Okay, and also on the pump side of things, there are a couple of things that I missed out explaining. I'll just... Over here, we have a couple of features. One of them is primarily to check whether there is any sort of bleed in the concrete mix itself. And then the second part of the pump is basically there is a relief valve, basically to make sure that if there is any air that is developed because of compaction as such escapes out. So, and then the, it is also the workbed, if you see, it's also removable in nature. So after the printing as such is done, you can easily remote, and that's it. Thank you.